Lectures 4 and 5 dealt with the forward kinematics. What was the objective? Given all these DH parameters, we can calculate the homogeneous transformation of the tooltip with respect to the base of the robot. In other words, given all the actuation angles or the position of prismatic joints, we determine the Cartesian position of the end effector of the robot and its orientation. Now we have to do the problem in the opposite way. Given a desired position and orientation of the end effector, where do we, what are the required angles of each revolute joint and the displacement of every prismatic joint to get the tip to that position and orientation? As you can imagine, this is a much more useful problem, because in robotics, we always have a target that we want to go to. So we specify that target, and our job is to determine in which configuration we need to put the robot in to reach that target at a given orientation. So the forward problem is simple. We just multiply our matrices once we find the right DH parameters. The last transformation gives us everything we need. The inverse problem is not as trivial, because first of all, there might be more than one solution to one configuration, as you saw in lab one. Remember that they had the robot reaching a certain position from different orientations. Or there could be no solution at all, depending on what we do. And the inverse of these equations is not as simple as their forward form. So let's see a few examples of that today. So the objective is to understand the concept of the inverse kinematics and calculate the inverse kinematics of simple manipulators. So the problem of inverse kinematics is that I cannot give you a general framework that works all the time, like the DH parameters or like the homogeneous transformations. Those always work. You put in the values and you get the output. So it's the same framework for any robot. It's not the case for the inverse kinematics. Every robot will have a different inverse kinematics based on trigonometric forms or whatever solutions, but we cannot find a single framework. So what is the point of the inverse kinematics? Let's assume this teleoperation network here. The robot mimics the position of the joysticks in robotic surgery. So I'm moving the joysticks, the robot moves along. What are we actually doing? We are calculating the position of my hands, scaling that up or down, and giving that to the robot as a desired position. So the tip of the robot must reach that point. So we have now a dynamic desired position that moves in time. And we need to now use that desired position and orientation to find the angles of each joint and the displacement of every prismatic joint that will satisfy that. And as you can imagine, that has to be done pretty quickly. And how do we do that? Well, we have to use the inverse kinematics. Here's another example. This was done in the lab by a master's student. It's the same type of teleoperation network. And this was, here's a simulation for kidney stones removal using a robot arm. So we do that through a small incision in the back. And the idea is that we insert a tool that you can barely see here with this dashed line. This is a tool that goes through an incision in the back, and then it has to be maneuvered towards the kidney, following a specific path that we determined before. And we do that by, this is the haptic device. This is the controller that we're using there. So now we have an additional constraint, because we want the tool to enter the kidney through a single point, and then once inside, we want to maneuver the tool to the stones, but now we have to maneuver the tool through the same incision point. Right? We cannot just maneuver it like that. We have to maneuver through the incision point. How do we do that? Well, we are imposing additional constraints. We are actually specifying the position of the tool tip every time, and also the orientation of the shaft every time we move it, right? So that it passes through the same entry point. This is lab 8. You will get to do that in lab 8.
How? Yeah. What's
the 0.6 for? 0.6? Where's 0.6? 0.6 is the tooltip. 0.7 is the entry point. These are the stones. And that's all.
Okay. Yeah. When you get through the 0.7, so at that point, you start to move like this way, right? Or you reach being set to some kind of point, you start to make the goal.
So the robot is pointing straight down, so the Euler angles are fixed downwards. Right, this is the kidney model. And then you position on top of the kidney, you go down. Once you go down, the robot now identifies that this is, well, we tell the robot this is now the insertion point. From there on, all the maneuvers will pass through that point. And then when you come out, it will come out like that and then return to the original configuration. If you want to read the full paper, it's just click here and you'll get the an idea what it takes to solve this problem. This problem was not solved analytically. We found a discrete version of it. We're going to see that in the next lecture. We call that discrete motion, differential motion. So in addition to now all these forward kinematics, these beautiful equations that we've been using, we're going to take their partial derivatives and create big matrices with them. That's going to be interesting. All right, so forward kinematics is what I've been doing so far. We know the angles of each joint, we know the displacement of all prismatic joints, we give that to the robot, that's the forward kinematics block, and we get in the output the position of the end effector, that is P, and the orientation of the end effector, R. We combine them into the transformation T. So in other words, find the homogeneous transformation T from n to 0 given theta 1 to theta n and given the displacement of all prismatic charts. All right? So that's easy. Saw that that's really easy, sort of, once we find the DH parameters. Now we have to do the opposite. What if I want the robot to go to a given position and orientation? Well, what we are doing is that we are specifying the homogeneous transformation we want it to go to. So we give now the inverse kinematics, the homogeneous transformation that specifies position and orientation. We do the inverse of that, and then the output should be all the angles and the displacement of the prismatic joints. All right, so the first problem, there's only one solution. We put it in, we get it out, done. Right? The second problem is not as straightforward because, as I said, we may have multiple solutions. Maybe we don't have a solution at all. Maybe an analytical solution cannot be calculated, but it exists. And maybe there's simply, or that there is no way to find that solution. So let's consider, for example, the robot you have in the labs. It's a 6 revolute joint. Right? And we have now a transformation that goes from 6 to 0. This is reversed. Right? Should it be 6 to 0? Given that a transformation, find theta 1 to theta 6. So when you get this transformation, you have 12. Remember, you have 12 variables. Right? You have a 4x4 matrix, but the last row is all 1s and 0s. Right? So that doesn't give anything. So we got 12 equations for that. There are 12 equations that we can equate to this when we want the robot to go there. So you have 3 positions and 6 orientations. But from the orientation, remember that out of the 9 equations that are inside there, only 3 are independent. Only 3 are independent. So you have now 3 rotations plus 3 positions, independent equations that I give them. So you have 6 independent equations that you have to solve for. Right, given T, find a way to solve the 6 independent equations. So these equations have sines and cosines. They are nonlinear. One equation depends on the other, and it's all a mix of different things. So let's see if we can find a way to do that. So first of all, we need to make sure that the solution exists. In other words, we need to make sure that the robot can go where we want and can reach that position with the orientation we want. To do that, we have to define what we're going to call the workspace. And the workspace is simply the collection of all points in space that the robot can reach. In the case of these two link arm, what kind of workspace are we looking at? What is the region that the robot could reach? It's simply a big circle. Right? So we can now define two workspaces. One is that a circle where the robot can reach. Any point in that circle, we can reach by calculating the correct theta 1 and theta 2. We call that the reachable workspace. And the second type of workspace is what we're going to call the dexterous workspace. And that means that the robot can reach points in within that dexterous workspace with any orientation. So the reachable workspace, you get there regardless of how the robot is oriented. In the dexterous workspace is a subset of the reachable workspace. Is a subset of the reachable workspace where any point can be reached in any possible orientation. So let's see. Let's take this guy here. If we find the workspace for that, the workspace is simply L1 plus L2, is a circle, right? Having a radius L1 plus L2. Does that make sense? And we can, if you only do half of it, assuming that the robot cannot go below its base, then you're dealing with a circle like that, which is already shown in your copy, I guess. Yeah? No? Doesn't appear?
Yeah,
yeah it is. It's your app. It's the same with mine. And that should show like that. Okay? What is the reachable workspace? Well, the reachable workspace is any point within this circle. Or is half of it, but it would have the other half here is perfectly reachable as well. What is the dexterous workspace? Is there any point in space that the robot can reach following any orientation of the last arm? Think about it. Are there any points that the robot could reach following any orientation? That is, the last arm can reach that point with any possible orientation. No? What about the origin?
The first one.
The first one can reach point zero with any possible orientation, right? You just align L1 and L2 like this. So now we are, the tip is always at the center and it can revolve like that. So it can reach that point with any possible orientation. That's the exterior workspace. It's simply one point in this workspace. Now, if we make L1 shorter than L2 shorter than L1, then what are we looking at? Well, now the workspace is a subset. The first one is that. Does that make sense? Any point there can be reached. Any point inside here, inside L1, cannot be reached. Is there any exterior workspace? No. Right, there's no point in space now that can be reached with any possible orientation. Right, so that is the first condition for a solution to exist. It has to be within the robot's workspace, of course. And now you understand why when you look back at that Da Vinci surgical arm, it has many more degrees of freedom than it needs to reach a point. Why? Because we want to increase the exterior workspace. We want to be able to reach points following different orientations. Why is that beneficial? Or maybe sometimes we want to avoid a sensitive structure. We want the robot to reach that point with a particular orientation, right? So we are imposing more constraints than simply a Cartesian position in space. So here is an example of that, now with multiple solutions. We have here a three-link robot arm. If you tell this robot arm to reach this point in space at a specific angle, phi, it can do that using two possible configurations, either the top or the bottom one. They are both valid. They both give us the same Cartesian position using the same orientation. Right? Don't forget that the orientation is another constraint that we impose to it. So the advantage of having what we call here a redundant manipulator that has more degrees of freedom than it needs to reach that point is that if we have an obstacle, for example, in the way, we can analyze all possible solutions and then select the one that avoids that obstacle. And of course, and that cannot be done analytically, we have to check all the solutions one by one. Here is another example, multiple solutions. These two reach the same point using different configurations. So this one is 180 degrees, is rotated like that, right? Rotated from the back. And same with the other one. Now the elbow is up or down of the robot. It's still reaching the same position, but following different orientations. Any questions? No? Yeah.
For the example of the obstacle, is it safe to say that much as phase two from the previous slide, where there's no dexterous?
There is a dexterous workspace for that one, because we have now three links. Right? So there could be, we have to analyze that, but I think there is, there's more than one point, now there is a region where we can reach following any orientation. Yeah. The obstacle doesn't affect that, right? That's a characteristic of the robot itself. Yeah. And the obstacle is an external constraint that we impose to it. Yeah?
Could you please explain again why the origin is at the exterior?
Right. So what we call the exterior workspace is a point that can be reached following any orientation. So if we put L1, link 1 like that, and link 2 like that, we are reaching point 0. And you can reach point 0 using any orientation like that. All right? So that's what we defined as the exterior Exterior's workspace. Okay, now let's do an example here. As I said, I cannot give you a recipe that works for every manipulator. We have to analyze these one by one. Luckily, unless you design a new robot arm, the inverse kinematics for most common structures are already available, and you don't have to redo all of them. Let's do one. Let's do this three-link planar manipulator. What's the most? What would be the first step to find the inverse kinematics? Well, find the forward kinematics, because the forward kinematics gives us a set of equations that are fully describe position and orientation. So if you use the DH parameters for this three-link mechanism, multiply all the transformation matrices, we can get the final transformation matrix here that brings the tip 3 to 0. And we'll have an equation like that. So in this notation here, if we have S12, that means sine of theta 1 plus theta 2, cosine 12, cosine of theta 1 plus theta 2, and so on. Right? So how did I get this forward kinematics matrix again? That's the multiplication of the transformation matrices from lectures 4 and 5. How does that help us solve the inverse problem? Well, because here we have the description of the tip position. X and Y and Z is 0. Here we have the orientation of that. Right? So the first step is to find the forward equations, and now we have to try to invert them. Given the forward, solve this system of equations that now gives us, what are we looking for? Theta 1. Theta 2 and theta 3, given the desired position of the tip and orientation phi. So we are specifying two things. We are specifying the Cartesian position, px, py, and you want the robot to reach that position at an angle phi. Is the problem clear? Yeah? So phi is an external input to the system. Now we have to find theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3 that will meet that requirement. What is the relation between theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3, and phi? Can we calculate phi from theta 1, 2, and 3? There's an explicit relation between that. Can you see it? Phi is simply
Theta 2.
No. No, it can be theta 2. Unfortunately, it's not theta 2. But it's theta 1 plus theta 2 plus theta 3. I'll let you think about it. See if that makes sense. Let's say theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3 are all 0. What's phi?
0.
0. If one of them is 90 degrees, what is phi? It's 90. If two of them are 90 degrees, then what's phi? 180. Does that make more sense now? All right, so we don't really have the freedom to choose all of them, because phi, once we have theta 1, 2, and 3, we get phi. All right, so that's the first equation. You're further constraining the problem now. By specifying phi, we have now a relation between theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. Are we good so far? Yeah.
Does that mean that, is this like a standard equation, or just like for this specific?
Just for this. Okay, so let me erase my notes here. So here we have the orientation specified by that we get once we have theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. And here is x and y, right? Px and Py, isn't it? Right? Those are the points we specified up there, Px and Py, that comes from the forward kinematics. So we can simply equate them. Yeah? So here is equations 3 and 4. We are simply taking the forward kinematic equations here in brackets and equating that to what they are, which is the position of the tooltip. That is now the input to our problem. So here is a tip for solving inverse kinematics problem. Let's try to now work our way from the tip back one joint at a time. We know Px, we know Py, and we know phi. Those are the ones that we are specifying, right? We also know the dimensions of the robot, all the arm length, A, 1, 2, and 3. So if we know the orientation of the arm, we know Px and Py, which are these points over here, x and y coordinates, we know the angle, we can work our way back to joint 2 by a simple trigonometric solution. Right? So we know this point because it's the input, we know this angle, we know A, so we can work our way back here from that, and now go from the tip of the robot back to joint 2. So what is the relation between that? What is P2x, which is the coordinate x of this point? What is P2x? Isn't that point minus this distance? What is it then? Px, exactly, minus A3 cosine of phi. What is P2y? Was Py minus that distance, which is A3 sine of phi. Okay, so now our problem is, we already reduced the problem by one joint. The only thing we have to find now is theta 1 and theta 2 that will bring us here. Right? Phi, we already have an expression for it. So let's go back to the first equation there. We have cosine of theta 1 plus theta 2 plus theta 3. According to the last equation we found for phi, this is the same as cosine of phi, isn't it? Same here, sine of 1 plus sine of theta 2 plus sine of theta 3 is the same as sine of phi, because we said here that a phi is 1 plus 2 plus 3. So I can take this point here, this part of the equation, move it to this side. That's what we get. I just rearrange in equation 3 and 4, moving cosine of phi to the other side. And what is the right side of the equation there? This right side of the equation is P2x. This one is P2. P2Y. Right? So we can simplify the problem by now finding expressions for these two. By simply rearranging these two equations. Does that make sense? Sort of. Yeah? Good? Okay, so good news. We now have a system of two equations and we have two variables. We should be able to solve that. Bad news, the variables are inside cosine and sine, so it's going to be a bit messy to find the inverse. Right. So let's do that. Here are the two equations we started from. Now, and somebody found a way to solve this easily, is to square each equation and then add them up. Square each equation and add them up to create a new equation. Right? It's a linear combination of the other when after they are squared. So if we square 5 and 6, you're squaring each term like that and this together. And then we add them up. That is the result. We can now expand the squares. So you have that part there is the squared portion for one, the squared portion of the other one. Now we can factor out sines and cosines that are squared. Use some trigonometric identity. I'll let you guys check this one later, but it's simple trigonometric identity. Things like this will be one. Things like that, cosine of 1, cosine of 1, 2, plus sine of 1, sine of 1, 2, magically simplifies to cosine of 2, and so on. All right, we can, if you're bored at home this weekend, you can work your way through the equations. But the solution is this. And the solution here is good because you only have one variable, only have theta 2 there. So what is theta 2 now? It's simply the inverse of this, right? So move these guys this way, divided by that, and take the arc cosine. So what is the expression for theta 2? Is P2x squared minus P2y squared minus A1 squared minus A2 squared divided by 2A1 A2 cosine minus 1. Yeah, this is getting interesting, isn't it? So remember that we may have multiple solutions. And one way that we used in the last lecture to avoid running into to keeping track of the quadrant where these angles are was to use the tangent 2 function. Remember that? How can you use it here? We only have one angle. We have cosine of theta. What's sine of theta, if we have cosine of theta? How can we relate them? We know that a cosine squared of theta plus sine squared of theta equals to 1. So sine of theta is 1 minus cosine of theta square root. So we have now an expression for sine of theta. Here you have an expression for cosine of theta. Right? We can now find the tangent of theta by simply doing sine of theta over cosine of theta. And then use the tan 2 theta as tan 2 minus 1 of sine theta cosine theta if we want to now use the quadrants to know exactly where the solution is. Right, you can use this or use the tan 2 function by artificially creating the sine of it. Okay, so this will help us keeping track of multiple solutions. Yeah,
But if we were to use just the time, we could have a different solution, but that is wrong.
No, it is still correct. It's still correct, but it wouldn't know, for example, cosine of, let's say cosine of 45 and cosine of 45 plus 90 are the same, right? So if you do the inverse cosine, you wouldn't know exactly where you are, but the tan 2 would give you that additional information. So and how do we find theta 1 now? Well, we have theta 2. Simply replace theta 2 over there in equations 4, 5, and 6, and work your way back to theta 1. Do you want to do that? No. All right? We can spend the afternoon here, so I will just give you the solution. So we got equation 7 for theta 2. We go back to the ones here. 5 and 6, that are only equations of only two variables, theta 1 and theta 2. We know theta 2, so for theta 1. So two possible solutions, either sine or cosine. Again, if you have nothing better to do, attempt these on your own. I did, and it wasn't fun. And I got it wrong several times. So I'm not going to go over that, because I think we can spend our time with something more interesting. So we can calculate theta 1 and theta 2 that way, or we can do theta 1 and theta 2 using the tangent function as well, because you have expressions for cosine of theta and sine of theta. So if you want to do theta 1 with that, simply do a tan 2 sine of theta 1 cosine of theta 1. That works as well if you want to keep track of the quadrants. We are missing theta 3. What is theta 3? We find theta 1, we found theta 1, theta 2. What is theta 3? Aha, 5 minus theta 1 minus theta 2. And there we have the inverse kinematics of this system. We input two Cartesian positions, px, py, and one orientation, phi. And then we get thetas that give us the answer. Okay? So let me give you an example here. So here is that same robot for random random link lengths. And what I'm doing here is that I want this robot, the tip of the robot, to follow that line. The tip of the robot to follow that line, and I want the last arm to touch that line at an angle of 45 degrees. So we can see the evolution of the robot in time as my position now is changed over time. So I could make this position time dependent. At time 1 it's here, at time 2 it's there, time 3 and so on. And then you see how the robot moves along to track that position, and you notice that the last arm is always at a 45 degree angle. Yeah. So I posted a MATLAB file that has that simulation. You can run that on your computer, and you see that in real time moving. And then you can play around and change the constraints. So it's this one here. Very similar to what I did in the last lecture. So what I'm doing is I'm creating a random trajectory. That is line 5 there. It's just a random trajectory, x of the trajectory. A trajectory is a collection of x and y points. So y is fixed, right? And x moves over time. And then I have this for loop in line 7. Oops, that didn't line 7 there. You see that the for loop is now taking one point of the trajectory at a time, giving that to the inverse kinematics, and the robot moves along like that. Right? So if you run this, is it running? Yeah. So if you do on the app, it doesn't work, but if you do that on your computer, you'll see that moving in real time. And then you should see something like that with the orientation. And then you can check the final transformations to see if indeed the end effector is where it is. So how do I have two steps here? So the first one is the inverse kinematics. I give the desired position and orientation. I get the angles. Once I get the angles, how do I plot it? I have to calculate the forward kinematics once again. All right, to get now the orientation of each arm and then plot it exactly like as we did in lecture 5. All right, so both of these parts are here. So take a look at it. I think this helps to understand how these different parts work together. Okay? So this is posted on Brightspace. You can check it there. All right. So if we change this robot configuration, we have to redo the whole thing. So there is no single way to find the kinematics of everything. Next lecture, you're going to do the inverse kinematics of the mecha.